Hello and welcome to this edition of the Q24 Newsroom. As you already know, Gabon went through a power change at the top of the Republic on August 30, 2023. Now the new head of state is named Brice Clotaire-Oligui Nguema. Hence, we are going to discuss the sanctions currently weighing on Gabon because of this coup and the current security issues in the sub-region. So this I receive and visit Dr. Jolime Ekomi, who is an American civilization expert. Hello, doctor.
How are you?
And also have Mr. Steve Obam-Abba, who is a teacher and also a consultant here on Gabon 24. How are you doing?
I'm good.
Okay, so before we move forward, let us watch this report. As the Prime Minister of the Transition, who was at the 78th Ordinary General Assembly of the UN, and he was there to explain what happened in Gabon and to show to the UN that it's not as they think it could be. Let's watch this element.
The address by Raymond Dongsima, Prime Minister of the Transition, to international public opinion here on the podium of the United Nations is a plea that faithfully recounts the events of August the 13th. We need to lift the veil on this act decried by international institutions but welcomed as a liberation by the people of Gabon.
Je me tiens devant cette auguste assemblée dans
I stand before this assembly in an unprecedented context for my country, which went through a frightful period following a chaotic electoral process that was interrupted on August 30 by the defense and security forces. Naturally, this intervention was condemned by the international community as a violation of democratic requirements and the devolution of power. However, for the sake of balanced reporting, and to dispel certain suspicions, it is useful to recall precisely the political context in Gabon that preceded and justified the seizure of power. It would be wrong from our point of view to give unqualified seizure of power. It would be wrong from our point of view to give unqualified sentences and to make easy amalgams out of touch with the realities of our context.
In front of the President of the 78th General Assembly of the United Nations, Denis Francis, Secretary General Antonio Guterres, the emissary of the President of the Transition, Brice Clotaire-Oligui Nguema, gave a chronology of the fraudulent mechanism put in place by the former regime to orchestrate an electoral holdup.
Tout observateur attentif, honnête, et de
Any attentive, honest, and bona fide observer of Gabonese political life in recent years has been fully aware of the deteriorating situation. Diverse members of the Gabonese opposition went to see the diplomatic missions and then together on August 9, 2023, went to see the special representative of the Secretary General of the UN for Central Africa, who lives in Libreville in Gabon. I'm going to say it here without ambiguity. Neither the political players nor the voters were prepared to accept another electoral holdup.
And so faced with history, the defense and security forces within the city high had the onerous task to assuming the share of responsibility.
Dans une telle logique,
given this logic, the defense and security forces had a choice between preparing to put down this protest of being prosecuted before international courts for their responsibilities or deciding to interrupt a fraudulent process that was dangerous for national cohesion. They have responsibly chosen the second path to avert the risk of a conflagration that would have shaken the very foundations of Gabonese society and would not have spared the many foreign populations living in Gabon.
The transitional prime minister, head of government, took the opportunity to sell out the action plan needed to enable power to be devolved to three elections within a reasonable time frame. He also called for the United Nations Charter to be reappropriated and for reconciliation with the aspirations of the people of the world for lasting peace.
Okay, so let's tackle the subject right now. Dr. Ekomi, we know that Gabon is now under many sanctions, you know, because the UA, even the UN, many international organizations have declared that the coup was not constitutional and that Gabon should come back to a kind of legal frame, you know, that everybody can agree with Gabon. Can you tell us right now where is Gabon, you know, located internationally speaking, from the sub-region to, you know, to international? And if, with what is happening now, President Oligui moving, you know, trying to reassure, you know, his colleagues, are things going to be better?
Well, you're asking a very challenging question, but let us start by the simplest one. So why have we been sanctioned? Yeah. We've been sanctioned because Gabon belongs to a region, and that region is governed by political organization, and these organizations are based on constitutional orders. So for you to be there, your country has to be organized constitutionally. So again, we sign a treaty, that is a treaty of ECOWAS.
Yeah.
And in the treaty, for you to be there, your country has to be, as they say, democratic, institutions have to be organized. The head, all the leaders, have to be the emanation of the population. If it's not the case, you're not allowed to be there. So that's a diplomatic process. So on the other side, the sanction are not, let's say, we don't have to see them as unkind practices and all that stuff. It's a process.
Like so it's normal? You think it's normal?
They are normal, despite the will of our leaders now to go around trying to demonstrate that what they did is good. The treaty doesn't say that to membership, you can be a non-constitutional state. From the time you are a non-constitutional state, there's no reason for you to be there. That's a political reason. Okay. Secondly, at ECOWAS, there is a derivation of what we call at African Union Peace and Security Organ, that is called APSA, okay. Architecture, Peace and Security in Africa,
okay.
Which of course is visible through what they call the Peace and Security Council. This Peace and Security Council might assume that whenever there's a coup, human rights, insecurities and all the stuff have to be controlled. Mm-hmm. So they call it early measures to respond to a conflict and then ways to solve it. So the first thing is to isolate. Now, it comes to the lot of the country to prove that what you think or what you don't know of our country, or what you think or
is happening
what you
here.
Know of the country, mm-hmm. is not true. Yeah. This is why we did this, and that is why we have this diplomatic tour.
Yeah.
Of the
what about Faustin Archange Touadéra? He came here twice.
That was
I
the
think
first.
It was to do what you just said, to check,
see.
To see.
First of all, there was a head of state who was considered democratically elected. Then he was of a front. Was he healthy? Was he killed? Was he in all the stuff? Then there might be in that situation acts of violence to the general population. We also have to check.
Yeah.
And then because our belonging to a region, we also have communities. We have businessmen who are coming from other states and have to be protected. So it comes to the organization to make sure that all these rights mm-hmm. are guaranteed.
Okay. So Mr. Abba, I want you and I to talk about the diplomatic tour, you know, of President Oligui. It's been almost 2 months now. He's been moving around.
I think.
Yeah. So we cannot know exactly what is his strategy, but we see what is happening. We see that he went, you know, from the first country. I think it was.
Equatorial Guinea.
Yeah, then he went to Central Africa. He went to Rwanda. Rwanda, Burundi. And some days
recently,
ago, he was in Sao Tome and Principe.
Sao Tome and Principe.
Yeah. So, what do you think is his strategy? We cannot know exactly, but I want us to discuss it. You know, what is his strategy? And do you think that that worked since he started that?
Good. We go from what the Dr. Kami just pointed out. You know, our country is in a very temporary situation, politically speaking. We are not living, I mean, under a constitutional order, which is the norm in the organizations or organism that we are committed to.
United African, African Union, and ICA, etc., we are committed to treaties behind those organizations. So the fact that we are not living, we're not under a constitutional order, somehow give those organs or organization legitimacy to isolate our country from activities. So those sanctions weighing on us are normal. They are understandable because they are legal. Mm-hmm. Now, we have a leader, the president, Brice Clotaire Oligingema, conducting a diplomatic campaign. I think, I would bet my bottom dollar that behind his head, the purpose is to try to bring more leaders, African leaders and international leaders on our side, advocating for the legitimacy with which the action that took place on the 30th of August was. So I think what he's trying to do is try to show the legitimacy of the action that military forces took on the 30th, and hoping that those arguments will carry a lot of weight in those leaders' minds, so that those sanctions can be mitigated. Because I think, let's be honest here, those sanctions are not going to be lifted up like that. Maybe we deserve mitigating factors because of the legitimacy.
Yeah.
All right? So I think he's conducting a diplomatic campaign trying to argument on the legitimacy on what happened.
I have one other question for you, because I have a friend of mine, you know, he sent me a message after Oligui went to DRC. You know, he went into the room with the president and he had his gun. He had his gun on his waist. And people from DRC were like, how can he come to the president with his gun on him? Gabon is a military country. Do you think that there is a fear? Because we heard about Cameroon that changed its military leaders the same day of the coup. We heard in Brazzaville where people were, you know, they feared that the leader of the Republican Guard, you know, did the same. Do you think there is a fear that Oligui represents a kind of, you know, threat for all that leaders, Mr. Abba?
For all leaders?
Yes, for the leader of the ICAS, you know, the sub-region.
Absolutely, it is. And I do understand. Why is it a threat? Why is our president representing a threat?
Yeah.
Look, we've been under status quo for too long. We've known president for life.
Yeah.
And it's still
42 years, 14 years.
Absolutely. And it is still real in a lot of African countries. Now, they are used to the status quo. Then overnight, they are taken aback to see, oh, man, we could never expect that.
Imagine
this would ever happen here.
Yeah.
So, you know, the problem with people used to the status quo is that whenever the tide try to turn, they're retreating to their own bubble and say, well, I think we are threatened, right? Our status, our titles, our ranks are threatened. Yeah. We need to do something in order to preserve that.
Okay.
What is real in our neighboring country, in the neighboring country, very rapidly can come down to us. So I do understand that we are going from status quo to a world-changing path.
Okay, Mr. Dr. Ekomi, do you think, like Mr. Abba said, that Gabon is now a kind of threat? I think that's new. You know, Gabon is a very peaceful country. We've been from 1960, we've been always, you know, the good guy of Central Africa. And now we have military in power and people are fearsome. What's going on?
I never take street debate. There's what people say on the street because of what they see, and then they're free to speak or make any comment. If we remain on the protocol, and let me go back to the APSA program, and then and you will understand why. So the APSA program is governed by five pillars, and one of the fourth pillar is a Department of Political Affairs, Peace and Security. So what happened is that the idea is to maintain our country in peace, and maintaining our country in peace, that is a country who's not governed by a dictator. So somebody who does a coup, of course, is democratically considered as non-constitutional leader. That's the form. Now, There are reasons. And then these reasons are what the protocol of what we see. The head of state is doing what has to be done. That is, after the action, they have to explain. If we are sanctioned, because that's the first act. That first act is, you are not here as long as you tell us why you did it. And then do you intend to normalize? Yeah. And then they go explain. So it's a normal process. Now, criticizing the head of state that he went to the head of state of DRC with a gun, that's a protocol. The leaders now are militaries, and they are symbols. Even the dressing style is a symbol. So it's not a threat. It's maybe a misunderstanding of what happens. These head of state, they've received them in that uniform with that gun. And they understood, because it's a military. And he's the one leading the country. Okay. So it comes to his lot to go to them with his military uniform, saying that we, the militaries, have decided to do this because of these. And he's touring to explain. So that's the process. Okay. And that is the reason why we have all these pressures coming here and there.
Yeah. And all this. And I don't want to talk about these pressures. Now, I want us to go to the timetable. The AU issued, I think, 2 days ago, a declaration. They said Gabon has to give them a clear timetable. And we know that in September, you know, just after the coup, they said they want at maximum 1 year. You know, so what can we say about this? Is it also a kind of threat, you know, to Gabon? Because we know the AU has not suspended totally Gabon.
No, I don't think it's not a threat. It's not that Gabon has become a threat. It's pressure. Way to ask Gabon to show their goodwill. Remember, part of our actions are financed by international institutions. We receive aids here and there. So if we keep on receiving aid, this money, where does it come from? It comes from people who pay for their state, and that money is collected to aid people. So they need to make sure that we keep on sending money to a country in which things are normalized, and make sure that this money is not taken by the group of people who took the state. This is one thing. It's just pressure.
Yeah.
And then, by showing the goodwill, we are not compelled, because they said 1 year, and then we said in 1 year, because of the size or the task that we have. The last thing is, yes, they are asking for a roadmap, but we have what you call a general roadmap, which, of course, is being articulated. If you read news every day, the prime minister is regularly communicating on what he wants to do, which dates he would like to launch the national dialogue, and all these things. So I think that we don't have to take it as the way people make a comment on that. We have to focus on what we are doing now. And I think the president and his team are doing a good job.
Okay. Mr. Abba, what you can say about it?
Well, what I can very rapidly say about it is that...
the timetable, you know...
The roadmap that the international community is asking for is understandable, all right? But they have to understand as well that overall, which has been done for 56 years, cannot be righted overnight.
In one year.
The problems we have are so deep and long ranges. So it's important for us to go incrementally into the roadmap, trying to put in place a groundwork that will ensure prosperity, that would ensure constitutional order, that would ensure transparency in election, and that would ensure commitment to international treaties. We need time. Well, what I do understand from those pressures is that, good, we are collectively involved in some organization, so we have to make sure that everybody is on track with our treaties, with the clauses that we all abide by. What they're trying to do, and that I'm trying to understand, is that they want to accompany our country. They want to go along with us in the process. Maybe they're not doing it, they're not communicating well.
Yeah.
We may look at it as sanctions or pressure, but I think what the international community or even the African Union is trying to do is try to just to communicate with us that we are willing to go with you, and you have to somehow have a roadmap, clear, detailed roadmap, and we are willing to go with you in order to get it done. So that's what I understand from those sanctions, if we could call them sanctions.
Okay. Right now we have, Dr. Kumi.
Let me add something. At ICAS level, part of the bodies that we have, for example, the parliament network, it doesn't have to be a parliament of people appointed. Mm-hmm. They have to be elected in their respective countries. So how would we do if we don't have elected MPs and senators? So that's why they say, okay, we'll give you 1 year. But if they see that we are proving we have the goodwill to do a good job and in all the stuff, and then understand that, yes, we said 1 year, but of course, they are objectively trying to do something serious. Yeah. It takes 3 years. Well, we'll give the 3 years, providing we see progress in every steps.
And would that counter you? They're also mindful. They're mindful. I think that they're mindful as well that the task ahead of us, the challenges ahead of us, are enormous.
Yes.
We cannot take them all.
We have no elected parliament. We have no. All our institutions are not working properly.
We are almost in a situation where we need to start our country from ground up, from afresh, to start afresh. So it's complicated. So 1 year, I think this is kind of...
Well, I don't think things would take place in 1 year. They're just making proposals.
Yeah.
And these proposals...
It doesn't look like proposal. It doesn't look like that.
Yes. What I mean is I do insist on the fact that they are making proposals and sort of pressure. And they're also waiting how we're going to react. Okay. If we are negative to their proposals, we make our proposal and tell them that because we are Gabonese and this is what we want and
it's
how we
our
want
country.
It. Yes, we'll run the risk of being sanctioned, or some states have started stopping their aids and all the stuff. But it's not because
the
they've stopped.
The U.S. has stopped.
Yes, they've stopped this aid, but we have to change the trend now. If we think that it takes 2 years, 1, 3, 4, 5, if that is the suitable process for us to get out of there and have a new state, well-built, well-constructed, that's fine. And the last thing is the biggest job now is to have a new constitution, which, of course, we shouldn't run with. So, for example, the U.S., it took time for them to have that constitution they're proud of today. And then for Gabon, it's the same path we are following. So
it's
not as if there's nothing on the way now, just that they want us to clear. We have diplomatic cooperation with many organizations, military cooperation with many organizations, economic cooperation with many organizations. At ICAS level, this is governed by principles and rules in a treaty. That's only that. So if we don't have the criterias, well, they are putting pressure for us to get back with the criteria, or else this would be considered a disorderous organization.
Okay, so I want you to say your last words, because we have reached the end of this show. But having in mind that President Oligui Nguema is presently in Brazzaville, and we saw pictures of him without his military attire, and is there as a head of state. What can we say, you know, as a last word about this move and, you know, the perspectives?
I think it also shows at from ICA's perspective that despite the diplomatic message that was sent to Gabon saying that we are excluded, we are still part of the process. And he is continuing the plea. If the uniform was a problem, then, well, it will no longer be a problem. That's what he is trying to show, the will of Gabon, that we didn't do it because we want to dwell there. We have a way. We have goals to reach.
Yeah. Mr. Abba?
Well, I think his military uniform the fact that a lot of leaders would perceive that military uniform as not unusual to their collective mind is when it comes to gathering, public gathering. Mm-hmm. I think he has understood that and is navigating between being a soldier at the bottom and being the president. So I think he's doing that job so fine.
Okay, so we have reached the end of this edition. Thank you, Dr. Ekomi, Mr. Abba, for coming today.
Thanks for having us.
Okay. So you can still follow our programs on all social networks, all over the internet, down the screen. And don't forget, life is only what you make it. Goodbye. See you soon.